Hi, welcome to the Knowledgeably Yours podcast. I'm Kaustubh, and in this episode, I want to share some thoughts on whether it is possible to quantify what is otherwise a human quality. Stay tuned. So let me start by narrating the incident which motivated me to think about this topic. Last week, after a very, very long time, I was getting ready for a long-awaited vacation. At least in my city of Pune, we've been under lockdown since the month of April, and only recently things started opening out, and we decided to go for a quick one-day getaway to a nearby hill station. So, just as any normal person would, one day before the trip, I decided to go down and check my car, and it refused to start. And then I checked beneath the car and found that there was fuel spilled all over. And when I opened the bonnet of the car, I realized that the fuel line had been chewed by a rat. I was very upset, but sprung right into action. I decided to get my car towed to the nearest service station. And once again, because of the COVID-19 pandemic, it turns out that the supply chain has been badly affected and a replacement part would not be available that very day. So that's it. I had all the bookings and reservations in place to travel the next day, but without a car to do so. And I had to resort to renting out a car. Now, there are many, many convenient services now available in India for renting a car. And the model is essentially the same. You go to a website or download the app on your smartphone. You choose the date when you want the car. Once the car has been confirmed, you go to the pickup point, complete a few formalities, and then you pick up the car. And after you finish using it, you drop it back to the same place and again go through some formalities. So I did the same, and thankfully I got a car. And somewhere in the middle of the journey, when I was checking out the status of my booking on the smartphone application, I discovered something. This particular car service, which shall remain nameless, because there is no particular criticism of this car service. The car service has been good, and the name doesn't matter anyway for the topic at hand. So this particular car service had introduced a feature where they gave a rating on the quality of your driving. And the catch was that if, according to them, you are better than 80% of the drivers who use their service, then you are entitled to some special treatment, some special discounts, etc. So in other words, here was an application claiming to quantify the quality of your driving, and that's how I started thinking about how people are trying to quantify everything, including quality. So let's spend some time understanding how this driver quality rating works for this particular service, right? So there are three parameters on the basis of which they rate the quality of your driving. One is the adherence to the speed limit. So they are clearly using a mapping service. That mapping service says that this particular road has this speed limit, and they have a GPS and speedometers and other sensors on the car, which are relaying the information to this car service. And every time you are driving at a speed which is greater than that rated by the map as a speed limit for that street, then it's a speed limit violation. The lesser the number of speed limit violations you commit, the better a driver you are. The second parameter that is used is hard braking. So if you brake gently, well and good. But if you brake very suddenly, that's considered as an infraction. The lower the number of these infractions, the better it is for your driving score. And the opposite of that, the third parameter, is hard accelerations. If you're increasing your speed gently, well and good. But if you are accelerating very hard, that's also counted as an infraction, and the lesser of these infractions that you commit, the better it is for you. So there are some basic GPS and gyro sensors that are installed on the car, which allows this car service to monitor your adherence to the speed limit, whether you're braking hard or not, or whether you're accelerating hard or not. And to be in the top 20% of their drivers, you have to commit as many, or rather you don't, or you shouldn't commit many of these infractions. So now let's ask the question, does this make sense in India, right? And I would argue it doesn't. Right. So speed limit, you have to appreciate the fact that a typical Indian highway goes through incredible number of villages and towns. There is flora and fauna growing all over. So even if a board announcing the speed limit was clearly placed once upon a time, the extreme rainy weather could potentially destroy it. The overgrowth of flora or fauna could cover it. So it's not obvious when you're driving on a particular highway as to what the speed limit for that particular stretch of the highway really is. And many a times, the speed limit does not even make sense. I have personally visited private roads, educational campuses, where they say that thou shall not exceed the speed of 20 kilometers per hour. Nobody was following it. Everybody was about 30 to 35 kilometers per hour in the speed with which they drove. But I decided to test one day what 20 kilometers per hour felt like. And it was incredibly slow, given the traffic, given the road conditions, given the overall crowd, the size of the road, the condition of the road, the speed limit just did not make any sense, right? I mean, I have even seen places where they say speed limit 10 kilometers per hour. Now you have to appreciate this is a laughable fact. If you are driving yourself on 2 feet, right? In other words, you're walking. You can hit 6 kilometers per hour without much struggle. And if you start jogging, you already hit 10 kilometers per hour. So essentially by saying that nobody should exceed a speed of 10 kilometers per hour on a particular street, you're saying that you should drive a car or a two-wheeler and you should not be faster than a person who is jogging. Well, those of you who think this is reasonable, I urge you to drive a motorcycle at 10 kilometers, 20 kilometers per hour. It is unreasonable and meaningless. So to get back to the argument, speed limit, the signs may not announce themselves properly. You may not even be aware of what the speed limit on a particular stretch of the highway is. Second, many a places the signs are arbitrary, they just don't make sense. The second parameter that they use is hard brakes. If you brake very hard, it's considered as bad driving. But again, at least in India, you have to brake hard very often. If you are traveling on a highway, there's a small village sneaking nearby, and there's a sudden vehicle that comes onto the road, unexpected, and this happens a lot. Or a stray animal could rush onto the road. And sometimes children play on the streets, and if they are playing a ball and the ball comes on the highway, a lot of the times the children are so absorbed in their game that they'll come running in order to pick up the ball. And then there are bad roads in many places, and until the last moment you don't realize that there is a speed breaker or a bump there, and you have no choice but to brake very hard. And if anything, if you're braking hard and there's no one behind you and you're helping avoid some fatal accidents, it should be a positive score for your driving effort rather than negative. The third parameter, hard acceleration, also doesn't make sense. On Indian highways, many a times you have these very heavy vehicles. They drive incredibly slow and you are stuck behind them. And the moment the two trucks in front of you or heavy vehicles in front of you separate out, you have to accelerate hard and get out and go ahead of them. Otherwise, you'll be stuck again for a very long time. So accelerating hard is very common on national highways where there's heavy vehicular traffic of trucks and other heavy vehicles. And similarly, there are a lot of mountainous roads, especially near Pune. The western ghats are a great relief for vacation seekers in Pune. And again, the overtaking opportunities are very, very low, and you have again very slow, very heavy vehicles on these ghat roads. And the moment you get an opportunity to overtake safely, there's only one way to overtake, which is to accelerate very hard. So the only people who can really score high on these quantified quality ratings for your driving ability are perhaps beginners who are scared of driving fast, who probably don't brake too hard because they're already driving very slow. They are overcautious. Now, my rating on this particular app was not that great, but I must, at the cost of breaking my rule of humility, rate myself as a good driver. There are a lot of co-passengers who have been beside me when I'm driving a car, and they really appreciate the fact that I'm very careful, cautious, alert, and overall I'm considered a safe driver. But according to these three parameters, I was not the best. And it's not because of that low rating that I'm making this podcast. So please don't misunderstand this. The concern is much more serious. The concern is that there is an attempt to quantify my ability to drive and use it. In this case, it is something harmless. At the most, they'll give me a little bit of discount if I am super, super careful and adhere to their standards of good driving. But imagine that instead of a private company, the government is using this data in order to cancel your driver's license or to increase your insurance premiums. Would it be fair? I would argue it won't be fair. Because if I am breaking a speed limit, one has to ask many more questions than whether a speed limit has been broken. What is the context? Was there a medical emergency? Was a sign announcing the speed limit for that particular stretch of the highway clearly visible? If a person is braking very hard, what is the context? Is the person braking hard to avoid hitting an animal or a child or a vehicle that has had an accident ahead? If the person is accelerating very hard, what is the context? Was the person experiencing some fuel issues? The fuel injection was not working properly and they decided to ramp up the acceleration to punch in more fuel. Or maybe they are on a mountainous road and they are stuck behind a vehicle and in order to take advantage of an overtaking opportunity had to accelerate hard. What's the context? A lot of our behavior can be judged only in context. So many times has it happened in public life that a person has made a joke, and instead of looking at the context in which the joke was made, only a single sentence from that joke was picked up, publicized all over the world, and that person was a part of a smear campaign, right? So many times it has happened. So should you have a quantity that rates your quality in a way that it doesn't really capture the essence of the quality, and yet that quantity is used against you. Let me give you a couple of more examples to drive the point home. Let's talk about a country which decides to implement social and ethical scores. So we decide to create a simple quantity which says, how many times did you shout? How many times did you touch yourself inappropriately? How many times did you bump into someone? How many times did you swear? And we will count the number of times you do this. We will create a social score or an ethical score. And we will do all kinds of things with those scores. Right? Do you think that is fair? I would argue we are not. It's not. We are all animals by nature. We are all lecherous, evil creatures by nature. It is only culture, it is only education and self-control that allows us to be humans. But once in a while, circumstances will manifest themselves where it will be hard for us not to bring out an animal side. And it is exactly for this reason there is an important concept in almost all philosophies and religions called forgiveness. And if we decide to quantify all these quote-unquote infractions of the social nature, we will be removing an essential element of being human, which is forgiveness. The other issue with scoring on social and ethical parameters is that a lot of times the context matters. If I am alone, there are things that I will say out loud, which I have always wanted to say. But as a decent human being, I would never say in the public. Because I'm very angry at someone. I'll use some words to talk about them, which I wouldn't otherwise use in a public conversation. And I strongly believe we all have the right to do what I call personal space infractions. We should not be judged. A decent human being is the one who doesn't have evil thoughts? No, that's not right. A decent human being also has evil thoughts, evil tendencies. It is the way they are able to control them based on the context is what makes us all decent. Otherwise, at the core, we are surviving animals. Another place where numbers are used to decide goodness is corporate employee ratings. Every quarter or every year, there's a massive exercise in corporates where every employee is given a rating. Maybe it's out of 3, out of 10, or some 5 grades, right? And based on these numbers that appear at the end, the future of an employee could be decided. They could be placed on a probation program. They could be given incredible salary hikes or promotions, etc. Now, here again, there are a lot of problems, right? So imagine there's a highly volatile superstar, right? Meaning there's a guy who or a gal, whatever, performs really well, solves a particular problem, one off. And because that problem was important and because the solution gets noticed, everybody is praising. And then the corporate employee rating for that particular user rises, right? So, but then there's this other guy. He always does his job super reliably. Nobody's noticing because he's doing his job patiently, calmly, peacefully. When you want the job done reliably, this is the person you go to. But there's a good chance, and I'm not saying all corporate employee rating systems suffer from this, but there is a good chance that a particular employee rating system could award an unreliable but once in a while performer better than the stable background worker who at the end drives the whole thing home, right? So there's a danger of purely relying on numbers to decide who is a better employee. And similarly, we are also using quantification in goals, right? If you want to set a personal goal, a lot of these life coaches, when they write their books, they suggest that quantify your goal. Don't keep it qualitative. They say things like, If you want to lose your weight, keep a target in terms of centimeters of your waist circumference or kilograms of weight and other parameters. Now, I'm not saying that these numbers are useless. They are important. We know that there are a lot of studies which correlate your body mass index with your lifestyle conditions and the health outcomes and so on. There's all kinds of correlations out there. But a lot of things that are missed out by these approaches is your personal feeling of satisfaction. When you wake up in the morning, how do you feel? Are you feeling light? Doesn't matter what that stupid weighing scale says or your blood sugar meter says. Are you feeling alive? Right? And when you over-quantify everything, like your goals and your aspirations, there's a danger of missing out that intuitive feeling that we must have of being alive and being happy. Another example that comes to mind where people could start quantifying and it could be dangerous is appearance-based profiling. Imagine that you walk into an airport or a high security area and there's a camera spying at you. It takes a photograph of you and it feeds it to a computer. And the computer starts analyzing your photograph and comes up with numbers. Now, if you are wearing shaggy clothes, if you are not wearing the regular footwear, or if you look sleepy or tired, etc., all of these parameters are judged by a computer to come up with a reliability score. And then, if your score exceeds or crosses a certain threshold, then a trigger might be raised to the security guards to examine you even closer. This is another danger of quantification. Whereas a human being would have said, this guy has probably been traveling so much, he's sleepy, right? A computer system could quantify it as likely to be a drug user. So there are all kinds of problems when you decide to take human qualities of reliability, safety, gentlemanliness, or ethics, or performance, and try and convert everything into a quantity. I believe that it is not always good. I'm not saying we should never quantify anything. There always has to be some quantification, otherwise this whole system could potentially break down. But if you or me are designing a system, we have to understand that there are a lot of things we cannot measure in quantity and there has to be a human element, right? So, but the problem is that as all these data collection processes are becoming very easy, it is possible for us to collect more data than ever before and all kinds of sophisticated machine learning and artificial intelligence algorithms are becoming available to us. I fear that we are quantifying more than before, ever more than before. And I think this is a dangerous path. And it is important for us to stop and take stock of what direction we are going in and whether it is a good direction to go towards. Should we really trade off intuitive analysis and let everything be quantified? I would strongly argue this is not the right path to be on. So as we continue to use newer technologies to quantify newer things, we should definitely stop and pause about where we are going and what we are doing and the consequences of this. Now, I'll leave you with one last thought. It is a thought of relativity versus absolutism. Imagine that you move to a house one day. You meet your neighbor and the first meeting goes bad. You hate your neighbor, and this is just a hypothetical example. But you notice that this neighbor of yours has friends in the neighboring houses. You notice that this neighbor of yours has a wife, has kids. The kids seem happy. but you hate this person. Is this normal? I would argue that this is normal. This is perfectly normal. It's perfectly normal for two people to be loved by their respective friends, neighbors, relatives. They can be perfectly good people in their respective groups. But when they meet each other, it just doesn't work. It just doesn't click. So that means that there is something that is incompatible. It is not a question of whether one person is bad and the other person is good, or vice versa. It is a simple question of these two people not being compatible with each other. So whether you like someone, or whether somebody is good, or whether somebody is a reliable friend, or whether someone is trustworthy, these are all not absolute things. These are relative things. But whenever we decide to quantify these things, right? Whenever we decide to quantify these things, there is a risk of getting rid of all that relativism and moving to an age of absolutism. And humans, as far as all of humanity that I have seen, humans don't work like that. There is a strong relative element in our existence. Everything is good, bad, preferable, not preferable, relative to the context in which things are seen. And too much of quantification, I believe, will come at the cost of the context. And this is not a good direction to go into. So, with this, I'll conclude with the hope that as we continue to strive to quantify more and more things, we will not lose the human element or the elements that make us human. Thank you so much for tuning in. Have a nice day.